did, and this is a mammoth exercise which was done by our people. 10,000 persons over a period of 1 month in scorching heat from 15th of May, 15th of June last year, went door to door and talked to each and every car. 17,64,000 cars. And in last 5 years, a minimum 2 years, they have lost their crop. So 12 lakh. Farmers having distress due to indebtedness, that is, they were having huge loans on over them, was almost half of them. So 25% of the farmers are saying that, okay, I'm okay. Another 50% say, I'm only having 2 square meals a day. And 25% are saying, I cannot have even 1 meal a day. The conclusion which we draw, number one, that the agrarian distress is not of recent origin. Number two, agrarian distress has not multiplied considerably in last few years alone. It has been there throughout. And I would venture to say that it started from the day we applied Green Revolution formula in rain-fed areas. Now, why I say so? There are very small number of societies in Orissa, Bihar, West Bengal. If you see the Green Revolution formula in terms of the bought-out seeds, consumption of fertilizer and use of pesticide, in all three indicators, these states are last. On the contrary, Yavatmal, in one of the districts where highest number of suicides are there, 30 crore worth of pesticide is used in 1 year. And then you have all those parameters. Complete seed is bought out, hybrid seed of cotton. Fertilizer consumption is huge. Pesticide consumption is very high. And rain-fed condition. So, if you want to predict how many number of suicides would be there, you can really find out in a rain-fed condition if there is no ancillary income and you are having a high cost input technology, then there will be persons who will be in distress. And that is the reason that if this area is being focused in a big way compared to Western Maharashtra or Konkan, where Konkan when you have Alfenzo and cashew nut, we are not saying agriculture is non-viable. I don't agree with this concept that the agriculture is non-viable and there is an undercurrent saying that large number of persons should be shifted from agriculture to non-agriculture profession. It will not happen in India. It is the choice of the technology by the farmer has made the entire profession.
But technology was suggested by the society, right? Every the radio you so, come up, you right. give this fertilizer, that
I
thing,
agree.
Right?
I agree.
Government so, gives all this blowhorn, yes. right? The yes. Chopal program,
so,
that's what they do.
Yes, so to that extent,
that's all I'm
scientists,
saying.
Our extension workers, our government, everybody is to blame.
Well, that's today, what I mean by society, right?
Today, Dr. Swaminathan, after 30-40 years of his entire formula, accepts that without a crop insurance scheme, to propagate Green Revolution formula in rain-fed conditions was a blunder.
If the insurance was that I am a farmer, my crop fails and then I collect insurance, it creates what's called this moral hazard problem, which is that I don't have probably the incentive compared to the next farmer to do the best I can because I'm going to collect insurance anyways. And there is no way to differentiate for the insurer between what has happened through a natural event and what has happened through some other reason, including negligence or whatever.
So, you require better monitoring. Yeah. It only says that
problem.
The insurance product will require better monitoring.
Extremely good
it
monitoring.
It will not. So, have that monitoring. Have that monitoring. Why are you asking a farmer who is weak to adopt a technology which is high risk
exactly.
and tell, I am not going to give you a crop insurance?
Yeah, I just told you what the problem is.
I would say that this is an intellectual failure of all of us, that we have not been able to design a crop insurance scheme which works for a rain-fed farmer. Why can't we have one single product saying that if you are losing your crop, you are going to get some compensation which is adequate enough so that you are not out of business? Or I would say, tell him to do low-risk agriculture. Give him a formula of low-risk agriculture which is there. Organic farming, and low external input, sustainable agriculture, there are technologies which are there. Because those technologies have not been discovered or invented by our great scientists, they feel those technologies are not worthy of touching. Because the people's, their own generation of knowledge is not recognized in anywhere, not in our culture.
Well, you saying that organic farming is viable at a large scale of all rain-fed agriculture in India being done?
Why not?
By
yes, yes, it is
by organic.
Yes.
Do you have any sort of evidence to?
Yes, we have evidence. We have got more than 100,000 farmers doing organic farming today in Maharashtra.
In Vidarbha
or no, entire Maharashtra, out of which 50,000 are in Vidarbha alone. There are farmers who have done organic farming for last 40 years. We have got documented proof of what they have done. There are hundreds and thousands of farmers throughout the country, not only Maharashtra, who have been doing organic agriculture and they have shown the path.
So then where is the catch? Like where is the problem in convincing?
Catch is person like me will not believe, will not accept that I committed a blunder.
So what has been done for promotion of organic farming?
As I said that we have got groups formed. Those groups are attached to a non-governmental organization who is good in organic farming. They build up a system where these farmers come in contact with those farmers who have already done organic farming. They talk to each other. Then there are training set up. There is an exposure visits. Then organic inputs at the farm land itself are generated. It is no bought out inputs.
Okay.
Not unlike in say USA. The entire organic input, most of it is being bought. But there it is, it has to be done at the farm land itself. And then do the organic farming under the supervision of these NGOs. They also help them to do certification. After 2-3 years, they are equipped enough to take care of themselves. And many of them have now got certification from ISCAL, IMO, all international organizations. The cotton is being sold at the rate of 3,200 rupees a quintal against 2,000 rupees a quintal in the local market, which is non-organic.
So the role that these NGOs are playing in terms of acting as resource groups for the farmers, right? Ideally, that role should also be played by the extension system of the government, right? So if we want to do it in a larger scale, then the extension system, first of all, has to be strengthened, and then also they have to be trained in the organic.
You're right. Now, on one side you say, we are going for chemical farming. That is a better formula. That is a formula which is accepted by the scientists. On the other side, we promote organic farming. That is why we adopted this path, because the scientists still don't believe in these technologies. So the extension system and those who are trained in that extension system, which has taught them only chemical farming, is not equipped enough to pass on these technologies to the extent a farmer would do who is doing organic farming for last 9 years. Now what we require scientists to do is to scientifically validate this data. To compare 35 quintal of sorghum, which is an ideal productivity level, which will be in ideal conditions, with the organic farming of 20 quintal per hectare is misnomer.
Yeah.
Because that farmer never got 35 quintal. So scientists keep on saying, my variety has a potential of 35. Show me that variety which is giving your average productivity 35. Average productivity is 20 only. Why don't you compare with the today's average productivity? So I am saying in every case they have got productivity more than what they were getting earlier, but not equal to what scientists are claiming one should get. Now those areas where the organic farming is popular, there are no suicides. We are yet to find a farmer who is doing organic farming and committed a suicide. Now this is the Prime Minister's package, which is again same thing, interest waiver, assured irrigation. You can see irrigation is having a major chunk, doing only 1.6 lakh hectare against 35 lakh hectare. So something which will benefit only 1.6 lakh hectare worth of land is having 65% of the input in the package itself. So our thinking to the package has not changed. Our thinking to the whole issue is not changed. As if we irrigate the land, the all problems would be solved. But that is the kind of thinking which we have. Seed replacement, watershed development, you can see watershed is 240 and assured irrigation is 2000. Then horticulture development, micro irrigation, extension.
What comes under assured irrigation? What are the exact?
That is your big irrigation project.
Canal based irrigation.
So at 4000 crore cost through watershed development, you are able to irrigate 20 lakh hectare. At 40,000 crore cost, you are able to irrigate another 20 lakh hectare, which is more economical. And we continue to have that kind of system. Okay. If you see the cost of cultivation, which includes the family labor cost and also the rent of on land, for any crop, the cost of cultivation is much higher than the minimum support price which he gets. It is almost 60%. Obviously, 40%. Now you will ask that why he is still continuing with cultivation. The reason being that the family labor, he is not getting paid. So he is working as a bonded labor on his own land. Oh, this I would say, please look at this. This probably is the future, what is going to happen in the area of agriculture. That farming communities are grouped together in the producer companies. That is PC1, PC2, PC3, producer company. Every producer company has a small and medium enterprise unit. There is a, it can be a dal mill, it can be a rice mill, it can be a poha making machine. Whatever they are making, there is a value addition unit attached to it. Then the corporate sector in between is the conduit which takes the entire product, grades it, packs it, brands it and brings it to the retail shops rather than running their own retail shop. You must be knowing that in Jharkhand, the Reliance units were attacked by the farm, by the retail shop.
4 crore worth of damage. That's what.
And with the main thing which they are saying is that you are taking away our business. Now, the question is that it is not only the farmers who are in distress. It is also at the small entrepreneur at the urban area, which is also in distress. They will also have to be a part of this entire chain. But the yes.
One question is this, which is that currently the way it is, right? I mean, what is happening is that the middleman, which is between the retail and the farmers, is taking away a lot of
that is, which is replaced by corporate.
Now, my question is, if that is replaced by the corporate,
where are they going to be?
No, that's it's a profit-making institution, right? So whatever it is, the surplus is being currently captured by the current middleman. A corporate unchecked can actually capture it even better. Right?
So how is the balance going to come? Whenever you have a public-private partnership, you always have a regulator. In telecom sector, you did the same thing. In building sector, you did the same thing. In India, wherever you have a public-private partnership, you always have a regulator. Why not have a regulator here? And in our contract farming arrangement system, there is legislative reforms which have taken place. There is an institution of arbitrator. Now that arbitrator will look after the interest because these agreements will be signed in the presence of the government unit. And then they will be the facilitator or the NGOs.
I mean, that's very key because without that, you're going to end up in a war situation.
So that is why today the clients probably will be making more money than the middleman.
Exactly.
Because since first thing, they are not working on technology dissemination.
And they're a monopoly. At least the middlemen compete against each other.
So that is why we say that this corporate sector is only to make that intermediate chain more efficient. Like it will require grading units, it will require packing units, it will require reefer vans, it will require transport of the produce from different areas up to the retail shop. So it's a huge system.
Set up more like how Amul is set up, which takes it all to the end.
So this corporate sector can be a huge Amul organization. Yes.
Owned by the
farmers. And Amul is not having their own shop.
Yeah.
Amul has not opened a shop of having a 10,000 square meter area and Amul is working through RS. That is their retail shops.
But they have their own transportation.
So I am saying that Amul,
even that the producer company and small medium enterprise, that itself is the key stage, right? That's also not happening.
That is not happening.
Yeah.
Because there is a farmer individually interacting with a middleman.
Exactly.
Today this is the model. Farming community, middleman, and
that PC is also a group of farmers.
Yes,
yeah.
It's a producer company.
That is
the key. So here we require your help. That how do we have this model really in place, where you require large number of producer companies, you find out what kind of value addition they should have, then organizing them, tie up with the corporate sector, then tying up with the retail sector, and then finally to the consumers. Okay.